Good morning. Welcome to worship at St. Mark's. Whether you're in-house or online, we welcome you to be with us today. We welcome Pastor Barbara Melosh back with us today. Pastor Kelly is at home, not feeling well. She should be back next week. Just a reminder, we have resumed communion at the rail. When you are done communing, you will take your cup and deposit it in one of the baskets on either of the side aisles. There are also some individual communion kits in the back if you would prefer to commune in your pew. We have resumed the black sign-in books at the end of each pew. Please take an opportunity at some point during the worship to sign in. We are not using the sign-in at the front door anymore. They will be collected at the end of the service. Adult ed resumes after this service at 10 o'clock in the seminary room. The topic is discipleship in a democracy. Next Saturday, we have our prayer vigil here in the sanctuary at 9 a.m. And the Lutheran Community Walk Run is also at Concordia Lutheran Church on Silverside Road. There is still an opportunity to sign up to walk or run or to sponsor someone. And then next Sunday is Rally Day. We have a combined service at 10 o'clock. Following that is a church picnic, and all are invited to that. I believe there are some more announcements to be had.
Good morning. I have two messages for you today. The first is about, it was over a year ago now, maybe 2 years, because Jan Sullivan stopped me one day and said, Barb, I'd like you to make a quilt or two for the LCS Walk Run, because her husband Roy, who was our liaison with LCS Walk Run for years at St. Mark's, and she said, I have all his t-shirts. So she said, would you like to make the quilt for us? And they could sell, auction them off as a fundraiser. And she told me it was the 25th anniversary, and I believe it because I think this year's is the 27th. So I said, yes, I would be happy to make them. And she handed me a bag full of 25 t-shirts. So each quilt has six panels from a t-shirt. One is hanging, one of the quilts is hanging downstairs now in the narthex. Three more are in process. It takes a while to make them, although during the pandemic I wasn't up to making anything. Trust me, I was home probably depressed as everyone else. Anyway, so they'll be done. They will not be finished for the walk run. And after speaking with Alec, who's in charge of the walk run this year, and also with Rob Gurney from LCS, they said, you know, it's a bad time actually to sell them at the walk run because there's so much going on. So we're gonna have probably an auction during the holiday season between Thanksgiving and Christmas. So you can purchase one for a gift. With each quilt, I have enough t-shirts to make a pillow also for each quilt. So that'll go along with this. And when they're finished, I'm gonna display them in the narthex. I'm gonna work with John to figure out another way where we can hang another hanger so I can hang them as they're completed. But one is done now and you can see it downstairs. More to come when I found out when they're gonna have the auction. The second announcement about the picnic on the 18th here at St. Mark's, it's rain or shine, so come on out. And when you come, bring a chair, lounge chair to sit outside in comfort. Also, if you like to make desserts, please bring what you'd like to make. We can add that to the dessert table. There will be plenty of food. And I'm looking forward to our own Arden Schindel, who's going to be the primary entertainment along with friends, I believe. But it should be a really great afternoon. So come on out and join us. Thank you.
Thank you. to the respective folks as well. Choir and Souls rehearsals resume this week. Souls rehearses on Wednesday, choir rehearses on Thursday, 7 p.m.
I invite you to stand as you are able. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who is eager to forgive and who loves us beyond our days. Dear friends, together let us acknowledge our failure to love this world as Jesus does. God of mercy and forgiveness, we confess that sin still has a hold on us. We have harmed your good creation. We have failed to do justice, love kindness, and walk humbly with you. Turn us in a new direction. Show us the path that leads to life. Be our refuge and strength on the journey. Through Jesus Christ, our Redeemer and friend. Amen. Beloved of God, your sins are forgiven, and you are made whole. God points the way to new life in Christ, who meets us on the road. Journey now in God's abiding love through the power of the Holy Spirit. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
Let us pray. O God, overflowing with mercy and compassion, you lead us back to yourself, all those who go astray. Preserve your people in your loving care, that we may reject whatever is contrary to you and may follow all things that sustain our life in your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. The first reading today is from the 32nd chapter of Exodus, beginning with the 7th verse. The Lord said to Moses, "Go down at once. Your people, whom you brought up out of the land of Egypt, have acted perversely. They have been quick to turn aside from the way that I commanded them. They have cast for themselves an image of a calf and have worshipped it and sacrificed to it and said, 'These are your gods, O Israel, who brought you up out of the land of Egypt.'" The Lord said to Moses, "I have seen these people, how stiff-necked they are. Now let me alone so that my wrath may burn hot against them and I may consume them, and all of you I will make a great nation." But Moses implored the Lord his God and said, "O Lord, why does your wrath burn hot against your people, whom you brought out of the land of Egypt with great power and with a mighty hand? Why should the Egyptians say it is with evil intent that he brought them out to kill them in the mountains and to consume them from the face of the earth? Turn from your fierce wrath, change your mind, and do not bring disaster on your people. Remember Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, your servants, how you swore to them by your own self, saying to them, 'I will multiply your descendants like the stars of heaven, and all this land that I have promised I will give to your descendants, and they shall inherit it forever.' And the Lord changed his mind about the disaster that he planned to bring on his people." The word of the Lord. The second reading is from 1 Timothy, the first chapter, beginning at the 12th verse. "I'm grateful to Christ Jesus our Lord, who has strengthened me, because he judged me faithful and appointed me to his service, even though I was formerly a blasphemer, a persecutor, and a man of violence. But I received mercy because I had acted ignorantly in unbelief, and the grace of our Lord overflowed for me with the faith and love that are in Christ Jesus. The saying is sure and worthy of full acceptance, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am the foremost. But for that reason I received mercy, so that in me, as the foremost, Jesus Christ might display the utmost patience, making me an example to those who would come to believe in him for eternal life. To the King of the ages, immortal, invisible, the only God, be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen." The word of the Lord.
The Holy Gospel according to Luke. Now all the tax collectors and sinners were coming near to listen to Jesus. And the Pharisees and the scribes were grumbling and saying, "This fellow welcomes sinners and eats with them." So he told them this parable. "Which one of you, having 100 sheep and losing one of them, does not leave the 99 in the wilderness and go after the one that is lost until he finds it? When he has found it, he lays it on his shoulder and rejoices. And when he comes home, he calls together his friends and neighbors, saying to them, 'Rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep that was lost.' Just so, I tell you, there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who need no repentance. Or what woman, having 10 silver coins, if she loses one of them, does not light a lamp, sweep the house, and search carefully until she finds it? When she has found it, she calls together her friends and neighbors, saying, "Rejoice with me, for I have found the coin that I had lost." Just so, I tell you, there is joy in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner who repents. The Gospel of the Lord. Lost and found, that is the theme of the Word of God for us today. In 1 Timothy, we have Paul thanking God for finding him when he didn't even know he was lost. And then Jesus telling stories about lost sheep and lost coins. One of my first memories is about getting lost and being found. When I was a little girl, my mother took my younger brother and me across the country on a long train trip to visit my grandparents, who lived in a small iron ore mining town on the Upper Peninsula of Michigan. My dad put us on the train in New Jersey, and we rode for hours and hours, the train hurtling over the tracks for one whole day and one long, restless night and another day. I had just turned 5 years old, and my little brother was not quite two, so my mother had her hands full. I can remember clinging to her skirt as we went between the cars and being very scared to see the ground rushing underneath us and to feel the metal plates of the coupling shifting under our feet. But my mother didn't have a hand to spare, so I clung on tight to her skirt as she carried my little brother and her stuff. In Chicago, we got off to change trains at Union Station. Have you ever been there? It's a big one. And she took us into the bathroom, which was also a big one. And in my memory, it went on forever, stall after stall, a long row of sinks. Well, I was a big girl, almost five after all, just turned five, so I went into a stall by myself. And when I came out, my mother wasn't there. What I didn't know was that she'd gone into another stall with my brother. But I didn't see her, so I ran up and down the room, dodging the other travelers, and my mother wasn't there. So I threw my body against the big door and went out into the train station. I looked around frantically, feeling more and more panicky, ran through the crowd, stopping every few seconds to look around again, but my mother wasn't there. Ahead of me, I remember seeing the big doors that led out of the station and into the street, and beyond them, the people were rushing back and forth, cars were honking. I reached the door and I hesitated, waiting for someone to open it so I could dash through. And then behind me, I heard a man yelling, "There she is!" And a big hand grabbed mine, and behind him was my mother, with my brother on one hip, running to me, dropping to her knees, and folding me into her arms. Well, that was many years ago, but I still hate to get lost. I am what has been kindly called directionally challenged. Now, these days, GPS has been a tool that I can lean on. It helps me find my way. But even so, when I'm going someplace I haven't been before, I feel a little nervous about getting lost. The gospel for today is about getting lost, so lost that you can't find your own way home. Getting that lost doesn't happen from just one wrong turn. Maybe it starts with that, but then you're on a one-way street, you can't turn around, and you end up on an entrance ramp to a highway that's going the wrong direction. Or maybe you're driving along, not paying that much attention, all of a sudden you notice you don't know where you are. Or maybe you get lost because you're following the wrong person, someone you thought knew where they were going. Or running after the wrong dream, the one you thought would make you happy. And maybe worst of all is the way you can get lost in your own life. Lost in what used to be your blessedly ordinary life until one day everything changes, sometimes with just a few words
I'm sorry to tell you this, but the lab tests show, or there's been a terrible accident, or your daughter is under arrest, or I don't love you anymore. And all of a sudden, everything you have counted on is taken away. And your own life is like one of those dreams where a familiar place has become a bewildering maze. If you've ever been lost, you will hear the amazing good news in the Gospel of Luke for today. In Jesus' parables, we have a God who loves us too much to let us go, even if we wandered away. A God who comes after us, even if we're not looking for him, who finds us when we're too lost to find him. A God who won't stop looking until every one of us is gathered in. But if you think you already know where you're going, you might feel a little impatient with this God. That's how the Pharisees and the scribes felt. They were religious authorities, faithful Jews, oriented to God's law, or so they thought. And they weren't wrong to care about God's law. But sometimes they had seemed to forget that it was their job to follow that law, not to judge. And that's easy to understand because I think every one of us has sometimes been there ourselves. Anyway, in this story, they're upset about the company Jesus is keeping. He loves a party. The guy will eat and drink with anyone. And they are scandalized about the disreputable people he collects. And worse yet, how much he seems to enjoy their company. So when he hears them muttering, "This man eats with tax collectors and sinners," he answers with two stories that start with questions. And away we go into the land of parable. "Which of you, having 100 sheep and losing one of them, does not leave the 99 in the wilderness and go after the one that is lost until he finds it?" Okay, wait a minute. This story starts with what seems like a rhetorical question. We're meant to answer, well, of course, we would go, but it doesn't make sense. What reasonable shepherd would leave 99 sheep alone in the wilderness to go after one? While the shepherd is out looking, a wolf could come and destroy a half dozen sheep, or half of the herd could stumble and fall off a cliff. Risking 99 sheep for the sake of one is not sensible. What the shepherd does is reckless. Then there's the woman who's lost a silver coin. Now, the other nine aren't going to wander off while she searches, so at first her cleaning frenzy seems fine. Worst is, she'll clear out the dust bunnies under the bed. But then when she finds the coin, she does the same thing that the shepherd does: start a party. Calls in the neighbors for an extravagant party, because in those days you didn't invite people over without laying on a very big spread. So she's celebrating the money she's found by squandering it all. What's the sense in that? This is who God is, Jesus is saying, a God who grieves so much over the one who is lost that God won't stop searching until everyone is found. If you've ever lost your way, been lost in depression, in anger or bitterness, lost in your bad choices, lost your bearings and got your priorities all out of order, been lost in loneliness or fear, felt so lost you can hardly remember home, well, hear the good news. You can't save yourself, and you don't have to. God is the woman who turns the house upside down looking for you, the shepherd searching through meadows and woods and thickets until he can throw you over his shoulders and bring you home, and then let the celebration begin. So come to the table, sinner, and join the party.
God has made us God's people through our baptism into Christ. Living together in trust and hope, we confess our faith before God and one another using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. As scattered grains of wheat are gathered together into one bread, so let us gather our prayers for the church, those in need, and all of God's good creation. Your people receive mercy, and your grace overflows in our lives. Fill your church with faith and love, and give understanding hearts to those who work to strengthen our ecumenical and interreligious commitments. Lord, in your mercy. Your creation groans as it suffers the impacts of pollution and lack of care. As the seasons change, renew in us the will to protect plants, animals, and habitats. Bless us with bountiful harvests that all may share. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
You provide hope through vaccines for COVID, monkeypox, measles, and many other diseases. Keep us mindful of those who are still vulnerable to the effects of disease, and use us as channels of your mercy and healing. Lord, in your mercy. God of peace, we pray for the people of Ukraine in the terror of war and the thousands who are fleeing their country. We pray also for the people of Russia and for Vladimir Putin, that his heart may be changed, that war may cease, and that your justice and mercy may prevail. Lord, in your mercy. Your world is shattered and the nations rage. Remember us in your mercy. Teach wisdom to our elected leaders so that we know peace in our world, peace in our homes, and peace in our hearts. Lord, in your mercy. Your children wander homeless and the hungry cry for bread. Seek out those who are lost or lonely, anxious or depressed, or struggling with addiction or illness. Provide for those in need. Today we also pray for friends and family of St. Mark's, especially the Ketchum family, Judy, Cecilia, Barbara, Gail, Bill and Bill, Wayne, Anne, Jean, Claudine, Gwen, Ruth Ann, Lynn, David, Jenny, Lisa, Dwayne, Fritz, Cindy, Jan, Peggy, and all who are sick or recovering from illness or hospitalized. Lord, in your mercy. Your work is done in this congregation with our hands, feet, voices, minds, and hearts. Build up the ministries of this community that we serve our neighbors and welcome the stranger in your name. Lord, in your mercy. In the privacy of this moment and in the silence of our hearts, we bring to you, O Lord, our personal prayer.
Your blessed saints who have died now rest in your presence. Give us thankful hearts for those who have been examples of faith in our lives, and receive us with joy when we come to share eternal life with you. Lord, in your mercy, gathered together in the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit, gracious God, we offer these and all our prayers to you through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. Gracious God, in your great love, you richly provide for our needs. Make of these gifts a banquet of blessing, and make us ready to share with all in need through Jesus Christ, who sets a table for all. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and Merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Christ invites you to this table. Come, taste, and see. Those of you who are communing in the pews, I invite you now to take your communion kits and know this is the body of Christ given for you, and the blood of Christ shed for you. Let us pray. God of the abundant table, you have refreshed our hearts in this meal with bread for the journey. Give us your grace on the road that we might serve our neighbors with joy for the sake of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. God who gives life to all things and frees us from despair, bless you with truth and peace. And may the Holy Trinity, one God, guide you always in faith, hope, and love. Amen.
Go in peace with Christ beside you. Thanks be to God.
I forgot.